Much of the history we in the English-speaking world have of World War II focuses on the campaigns in Russia, Messerschmitts dogfighting with Spitfires over London, and the massive island campaigns in the Pacific between the Japanese and Americans. But one of the two founding members of the Axis powers, Italy, receives much less attention, as its involvement does not neatly fit into the narrative of the World War, having begun operations as a fascist state in the 1920s and leaving the war early in 1943. The post-armistice period, however, was arguably the most difficult for Italy, as the civil war that broke out between the fascists, communists, and ordinary people took a tremendous toll on the social fabric of Italian families, and over 1 million men were forcibly taken to Germany to work in their war factories. Piero San Giorgio, grandson of one of these men, joins us tonight to tell his story.
Well, I'm not a crook. I burned everything I've got.
Military industrial complex.
A new world order.
But we are here to destroy the control over the industry of other people.
I did not trade arms for hostage.
It's been time to get it.
Наполни разгром гнусный захватчиков.
Мифов о детуинте в Синчеви Паскар.
Hello and welcome to the Myth of the 20th Century. It is our first episode of the year 2021 and our 201 episode. We have the pleasure of being joined by a very special guest who has come on before, but this is his first appearance after the demolition of the United States, as we're anticipating very shortly. But Piero San Giorgio comes from Switzerland. He's a very prolific author. He focuses on survival and writing about potential collapse of advanced industrial economies. And so we've talked to him about that before. But today we wanted to talk about a story that he wrote about a person who was captured during World War II and forced to work for the German government. And it's titled Giuseppe. So this person, if you couldn't already figure out, comes from Italy. And I wanted to ask you, Piero, is this a true story?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for your invitation. And it's always nice to have to be on a channel where we can have a free discussion. And we hope that it's going to last. So this is a story of my grandfather. My grandfather, Giuseppe Vercelli, who was born in 1906 in Italy. And I tell his story. It is a true story. And I had to fill whatever holes in the story that unfortunately I couldn't find through the interviews of many other members of my family, people who met him. And of course, being a story set in the 1920s, 1930s, 1940s, in Italy and in Greece and in Germany during the war, it was very difficult to find accounts, for example, of his stay in the camp. He was a prisoner in Germany, so I had to go to see archives. It was very hard to find, of course, personal stories, because that was not the point of that institution. However, I did find information about the mechanics and how life was organized in those places. And I want to precise that this was an internment camp for prisoners. It was not a concentration camp for political prisoners or for others. So I want to be very clear. This is not a story about Jewish prisoners in camps or something like that. It is an Italian national. And I think it's a story that many people outside of Italy don't really know. So the story is completely true. I, of course, had to imagine some of the interaction with, for example, some of the prison guards. And, for example, to give another idea, my grandfather told me about how he came back and how he negotiated him leaving the German area where he was in while in custody from the Soviet Red Army, who liberated him at the end. I explained that towards the end of the book. And he said that he came back by foot. And he gave me some anecdotes, and I had to figure out from my memory, from interviewing people, how could he walk back from East Germany, from what is now eastern part of Germany, what was then also eastern part of Germany, back to Italy by foot. And I figure out that, of course, there were some elements of the story which had to be different. For example, he had to take the train to go back from Italy, from München, from Munich in southern Germany, who was occupied by Americans. And I did find out that Americans did organize repatriation of prisoners of war, of Italian prisoners of war, to Italy by train. So, in fact, he did not do 100% of the trip by foot. He probably walked from Germany, from eastern Germany to München. And I figured out that he must have had train transport from München, so I make that account. So I kind of crisscross through archives, through personal memories of mine and personal memories of people in my family to make a story that is not just the story of one man, a small little man in the middle of the big history, but also to show some of his feelings that he might have and that he had, and as he told me. And of course, as I write in the postface of the book, where I give my account of how I wrote the book, it is always very difficult to write books based on memory. And as we know, memories can be exaggerated. Memories can be also mitigated in a way. Sometimes people are shy. They are, especially simple people of those times, at least people from my community, they don't exaggerate. They don't tell stories of heroes. They don't tell story of extreme suffering. In fact, they tend to be minimizing what happened to them. They say, oh, it wasn't that bad, when in fact I know that it was very bad because it was the war. And so this is, I would say it's a probably 80% true story, and 20% I had to fill the gaps by poetic license, as we say in writing. And I tried to be as realistic as possible in the terms of those times, just as well as I had to, and I wanted to do that. I wanted to give a voice, of course, to Italian people of the times. I wanted to have to give a balanced voice. And so in this book, they're communists speaking, they're fascists speaking, they're Nazis speaking, they're Russians speaking, they're Germans. There are all sorts of people from the time who basically have to make up with the situation, have to go along inside that difficult time that was the World War II and the years before World War II. And I tried to make a story of, a simple man, and I mean this in a very positive way, a simple man in very dark times, very difficult times.
Well, I think a lot of people don't know that Italy was not part of the war after 1943. And what happened to Italy was not only was part of it being bombarded by the Americans, in their very famous book called Catch 22 that most school children in America are taught. And this actually describes this process where the bombers were flattening much of southern Italy. But the north of Italy was occupied by Germany. And this, I suppose, was what happened that caused your grandfather to go into this labor camp. The politics of that are very complicated, but I just wanted to explain right off the beginning how people could understand this context. But the book starts actually before the war. It's during fascism, the beginning of fascism, or at least right after World War I, and then soon thereafter Mussolini takes power. So Italy was actually a very damaged place. It actually lost more people during the First World War than it did in the Second World War. And a lot of people were leaving, and the people that stayed were more interested in a different way of life. And I think this is how Mussolini took power. And I think your book talks a little bit about what this was like. And your grandfather in particular, I believe, worked in the cement industry, which was one of the key industries that Italy tried to promote as something that demonstrated the industrial progress of the nation. Could you talk about how the beginning of the book was for your grandfather?
That's correct. And in fact, my grandfather was telling me of his very first memories during and just after World War I, which was a disaster for Italy. It was a victory, nominally, but it was a disaster humanly. It was a disaster economically. And politically, just as many countries at that time, there was a lot of turmoil after the war with communist revolutionaries trying to topple the country and take power, just as they did in Hungary, just as they tried to do in Germany and succeeded in 1917 in Russia. And at the same time, there were different brands of socialism fighting for power. And obviously, there were the traditionalists, the royalists. Of course, Italy was a kingdom at the time. The Christians, Catholics, precisely, who had very different range of morals from the communists, of course, but some of them supported a halfway socialist movement, the Christian socialists. And all of that was in the middle of an economic depression, because suddenly the production for war stopped. And the early 1920s were a time of very strong political strife. And Mussolini, who was a socialist, he was clearly, and in fact was the owner of the socialist newspaper, basically ended up regrouping some of the nationalists, the veterans of the war, and managed to strike a deal with the industrialists, the owners of the large industries and the agricultural lands. Italy was unfortunately a fairly poor country at the time compared to others. And that kind of negotiation of a deal enabled him and his fascist troops, which at the time fascist was not a bad word as it is today. It was a political movement that was actually admired by many famous leaders across the world. Winston Churchill was not shy of saying how much he admired.
Yeah, including Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president of the United States in 1933. He had actually, his wife in particular, had talked fondly of the Mussolini government.
Yeah, and it is, so at the time it was quite politically acceptable movement, and that ended up through a sort of half a coup that the king of Italy nominated Benito Mussolini as a prime minister. And through different approaches, he consolidated both his power, but also his policies really did put Italy back to work, reducing unemployment, putting the industries to develop for both internal markets, but also for exports. And the people of the South, for example, who were migrating en masse to Argentina, to America, to Canada, suddenly had jobs. And the country was very happy and very satisfied of that regime, which certainly moved to a bit of a more authoritarian approach, but it was nothing of the kind that you could see, for example, in the Soviet Union at the same time, which had millions of people killed or sent to the gulag, and certainly had nothing comparable to, for example, Nazi Germany in terms of authoritarianism and even racial policies. Italy is a fairly, well, I wouldn't say homogeneous, but certainly it is homogeneous racially, if not culturally. And certainly it was successful. And up until the start of the war in 1940 for Italy, the people were extremely satisfied, to the point that even communist opponents to the regime of Mussolini wrote in private letters that it was a fact that almost 100% of the people were satisfied, including communists, because it had this balance between socialism and nationalism. And at the same time, it allowed for businesses to succeed and make money. And so it was a kind of a hybrid between capitalism, socialism, and nationalism. And it was very successful. And indeed, it was admired by many other people across the world. And in those times, well, my grandfather was a young man, and he, as many young men, he wasn't interested so much about politics. He He was happy to have a job indeed in the cement industry. And I describe in a few chapters how was that life. It was not an easy life, but it was well paid compared to other jobs at the time. So he could develop when you're young and you see that the future is brighter, you're happy. You see that, you start your life with one pair of shoes, and then you can buy a bicycle, and then you can ride to the local city and go to dances on Saturdays evenings, and perhaps meet some woman and have a fiancé and things like that. This is what young people want, and this is what that system allowed. And while he wasn't political at all, and in fact, in the industry of mining, of course, he wasn't a manager. He was deep in the mine shafts, breaking the stones to get the cement ore out, and so that the factory could produce the cement that was exported to many other cities across Italy. Well, even that was a kind of a socialist environment, and yet people didn't really care. They said, well, after all, our jobs are good, our salaries are improving, so everything is fine. And when you're young, this is enough. And so I describe how we developed, how he grew up in Italy of those times, what kind of entertainments they had, the passion for football, I mean soccer at the time. And Italy was twice world champion in 1934 and 1938, so that gave a lot of prestige for people, and this simple happiness was what constituted the good life, and that went on at least until Italy went on to war.
So, what were the reasons for Italy going to war? I have my theories, and many historians have wondered if this was more Mussolini than Italy, but maybe you can explain what the motivations were.
Well, of course, I will tell you my thoughts, but my grandfather's had no idea. He was not interested in this thing, even if I describe in his book how he went through military service. And I remember he was telling me that they were basically training how to march, how to obey orders, how to recognize and salute ranks in the proper way. So the army wasn't really fascist. It was still the old Kingdom of Italy style army. It was very process oriented, very much about numbers and parade. And it was really not well trained at all, even by the standards of the time. They had nice looking uniforms, but quite bad equipment, and equipment was lacking for most people. And he did part of his military service in Libya, which was an Italian colony at the time. And unfortunately for them, they hadn't discovered the petrol that was under their feet. Otherwise, they would have been rich. but no, they didn't know there was oil. Oil was discovered after the war. And so in that very poor place, Italy was dreaming of, and Mussolini was dreaming, and his propaganda machine was pushing the idea of a new Roman Empire. And so a lot of colonists Italian colonists were settled in Libya from 1911 onwards, in fact. And my grandfather was there in the desert. And I remember as a small child that he was telling me, for example, the stories of how he met in Africa, in Libya, a dinosaur. And as a child, I was laughing that he was telling me stories about the dinosaur. And of course, as I grew older, I figure out that it wasn't at all. It wasn't obviously a dinosaur. It was just bones in the desert that looked like bones of dinosaur, but in fact were bones of whales and sea whales. Because obviously 20,000 years ago, part of Libya was an ocean, was part of the Mediterranean. It was, the waters were higher. Probably they also had global warming at some point. But the idea was to show that there was, in fact, lack of preparation for the war, as seen from even simple people who were simple soldiers could see that Italy was not prepared for any kind of war. And it came as a surprise in 1936 when Italy was involved in the Spanish Civil War and had to send its best equipment and best troops over there to mitigate the result. and in 1937-38 went to war against Abyssinia, which is Ethiopia, which was one of the last independent countries, only independent countries in Africa, and won quite spectacularly, and using all the modern equipment of the time, including combat gas, including, of course, aerial bombing and fast-moving tanks. And so that gave the illusion, I think, to Italians and to the leadership, especially Mussolini, that Italy was a powerful war nation and was able to conduct war just as well as Germany, just as well as France, which was considered the best army in the world at the time. And when in 1939, Germany went to war, and actually I forget to say that Italy became an ally of Germany, and I think Italy was pushed by Anthony Eden, which was the Prime Minister of England. So what I'm saying now is not what my grandfather told me, because my grandfather probably didn't even know who was Anthony Eden, and as he was in his daily life. But I have to comment, and I add comments in the book on some of the geostrategic things that are happening at the time, that were happening at the time, just to explain to the reader why suddenly something happened. But for example, in that case, my grandfather could never know about the conference of Stresa, which basically showed that Italy was not very fond of Nazi Germany, especially because of its expansionism and annexing Austria. And one has to remember that Anthony Eden, as a foreign minister of Britain, basically pushed for the Society of Nations to make embargoes and economic sanctions against Italy when Italy attacked Abyssinia, which was considered by Italy extremely unfair, since England ruled half of Africa and half of the world and had colonized and made war to so many nations, and so did France, and so did other nations. And why would they not allow Italy to do the same? So it was considered as unfair. And of course, we today think that why would all of these nations go into those places? Makes no sense, but okay, it was so at the time. And that pushed Italy towards the only other European power who was supporting her, which was Germany. And one has to remember that Mussolini was fluent in German, and Hitler was a very seductive personality in private, it seems. We have some accounts of the encounter that Adolf Hitler and Benito Mussolini had at the Brenner Pass in 1938, when they decided to make the alliance, the Steel Pact?
Pact of Steel.
Pact of Steel between Italy and Germany, and then that became the alliance, which included also Japan later on. And when Germany went to war, of course, that alliance was a defensive alliance. Italy stayed neutral. In 1939, when Germany went to war with Poland, and when Britain and France declared war on Germany, Italy also stayed neutral. And it was only on June 10th, 1940, when it was obvious that Germany won the war, was winning against France and Britain at some point at the time, Mussolini decided it was time to go to war as well, to support its ally and to, as he said, buy a place at the table of negotiations. And he was absolutely certain that war would end in a few days. He was absolutely certain that there and then Italy would be able to get a few spoils, such as probably maybe Malta, maybe parts of the south of France, like the town of Nice, which used to be Italian in the late 19th century. And that was a miscalculation, because first of all, Italy was not prepared for war. The war was declared on a whim. There was no military preparation. There was no economic preparation. Most of the merchant fleet was across the world and was captured by Britain and or interned by neutral nations such as America and others. So Italy lost like half of its shipping capacity in a few days, and the war went on, and many Italian generals and military actually warned Mussolini that going to war against Britain, which had the largest fleet in the world, would be very dangerous for the Italian fleet, They warned that the Italian army was unprepared, but Mussolini said, well, we performed well in Ethiopia and Spain, therefore we will perform well against whoever is on our path, but it didn't. And that started a war which lasted much longer than Mussolini believed. And then Italy had no initiative, and the military disasters started very quickly.
Well, I think the role of Britain cannot be undersold. I remember researching this a few years ago, and I was looking at very old news articles talking about the government of Italy during the 1920s with Mussolini. And Britain was already doing its best to try to win the propaganda war against Italy. I think they saw a problem there. And I agree with you. The British were some of the biggest colonialists in Africa and in North Africa as well. And I cannot see this any other way other than that they saw the competition in Egypt and the Suez Canal and things like that, that they didn't want to deal with an expansionist power in the Mediterranean. They also were key proponents of sending the Allied forces in Europe to Italy first, as opposed to Germany, or through France, rather, but ultimately to Germany. They began the campaign in southern Italy over the objections of the Americans, who actually wanted to attack Germany first. So the British, which, again, it's very ironic, the British were actually very instrumental in creating Italy to begin with. It was sort of a counterpoint to the other empires or powers within continental Europe, and they supported Garibaldi's movement, and I think it's a very old British strategy of supporting the weaker player and then destroying them if they become too strong.
That's true. In fact, it's off topic, but certainly when Garibaldi invaded Sicily, it was, this is not taught in Italian schools, of course, and still not today, but it's well known that Britain bought all the officers of the army of Naples to surrender. Not unlikely what happened in the recent war in Libya, where NATO powers bought the army commanders of Muammar Gaddafi's war machine to surrender and drop. And when you look at it, it was against part of the game, against Austria-Hungary, which was an empire that could be rival to Britain in the Balkans. And of course, in the late 19th century, Sicily, which was part of Naples, had the biggest the biggest source of raw material for the match industry, you know, the light.
That was sulfur.
And the sulfur from the Etna. And sulfur was very important as a strategic material then.
Yeah.
For the industrialization of and the gas, using of natural gas in Britain. Not unlikely what, you know, Britain played to control the Middle East from around the 1910 for getting control of the new source of energy, which was oil, which was becoming essential for the British fleet. So sometimes, yes, the empires, and Britain was very efficient in that, do play other powers, minor ones, against others. Italy, indeed, Britain supported Italy on its war against the Ottoman Empire in 1911, 1912. I completely agree that it was Britain, foreign policy, who pushed Italy to be allied with Germany and created the conditions for World War II, in fact.
Yeah, Mussolini was very proud before the war began. And I do think that when he met with Hitler, he felt like he was the senior partner. During the war, however, I think that changed very quickly. And to the point where Germany actually had to come in and save Italy in their campaign in Greece. And I think your book talks about that a little bit.
Yes, that's correct. So when the war started and, you know, Italy probably should have concentrated on conquering Malta and perhaps securing North Africa against the British in Suez. But instead, Mussolini probably wanted to make a show to Hitler and showing him that he could be managing his own campaigns, and launched a war against Greece, which was even ideologically a very strange decision, as Greece was very close to Germany and Italy in terms of political ideology. And that war, which was supposed to be on paper quick, because clearly the Italian army and forces were superior in numbers and perhaps even in quality, but certainly launching war in the mountains of Greece across Albania, because Albania was an Italian territory at that point, in the middle of autumn when there's lots of rain. Actually, I think the war started on October 28th, 1940. Ended up in a disaster. And my grandfather's unit was called, as part of the second echelon, the second offensive against Greece, which was to start in February 1941. And Mussolini really put a lot of troops and means, because he had to show that the second offensive would be successful. And that coincided with the fall of Yugoslavia, by the way, with the coup d'etat against the king of Yugoslavia in 41. And when my grandfather was fighting in Greece, Germany intervened in Yugoslavia on the side, of course, of Italy, and also pushed through with even the help of Bulgaria with really a very daring campaign of paratroopers. We call this vertical envelopment, dropping paratroopers on the mountain passes and even on the Canal of Corinth, and had a very brilliant military campaign against Greece. And Greece was quite successful fighting off Italy, just collapsed as its front was pierced by German mechanized intervention and forces. And so my grandfather ended up spent the next 2 years of the war as in a duty of occupation of Greece. His unit was a second line unit, because he was already old. He was 30 years old, so it's not the prime age for troops. So he was on occupation duty. So there's quite a lot of chapters that describe how Italians were a bit ashamed, in fact, to occupy Greece, which was a friendly country, which was population was not dissimilar and poor as well, just as most Italian soldiers were in their own families. And they were really wondering themselves, why are we in Greece and what are we doing here? I show how the morale and determination, even if they were in fact victorious conquerors of Greece, there was something that was broken in the Italian morale. Whereas the Germans occupied Greece without second thoughts, and were actually fairly efficient, in even sometimes in a brutal and dark way, in their occupation, but they just considered it was a strategic land that enabled them to threaten British interests in the Mediterranean, and from there hop on the Middle East. So they had a much more better strategic vision. For Italy, Greece was something like an annexion, a country that would be part of the new Roman Empire. But that's a silly vision in the 20th century, where at least Germany had the vision of the natural resources of the Middle East on its side. It didn't succeed, but at least it was part of something that had coherence in a strategic sense. And while Germany was fighting on in the Middle East, in North Africa, across the Channel against Britain, but also with Operation Barbarossa in against the Soviet Union, Operation Barbarossa, in which Mussolini also sent an army, a small corps, which then became the Italian army in Russia, a lot of Italians were wondering, but are we going to war against the whole world? Because we started against France and Britain because we had some limited objectives, and now we end up in Greece, in Albania, in Yugoslavia. We are fighting in Africa. We are fighting in North Africa. We are fighting in the southern Russia. We have to send our mountain troops in the Caucasus. I mean, come on, who and of course they declared war against America, and the first campaigns started against Italy, and every campaign ended up as a loss. Italy lost Ethiopia, they lost Eritrea, they lost Libya, and they were starting to be. They lost Tunisia, they lost the bombing campaigns of American and British bombers started to attack Italian cities, and the industries of Italy were not as flexible and resilient as the ones of Germany proved to be. And suddenly you had an agriculturally rich country like Italy, who was suddenly not able, because of infrastructure being destroyed, to able to feed its population. And morale suddenly became very low. And this is what led to the armistice that Italy signed with the Anglo-Americans on September 8, 1943, which was itself managed in an incredibly disastrous way.
How do you think Italian culture has changed and been perceived from the time of your grandfather till now? Like, there's this tendency now to conflate Italy with socialites and fashion and beautiful cars and amazing cuisine and art, and a lot of Italian culture is now sort of aggregated into those key elements, and it's as if it's always been that way going back to the Renaissance. But during your grandfather's time, it seems like Italy was internally people thought of themselves as a much different place. How do you think it's been changed internally and in how it's perceived both abroad and by Italians?
Well, that's an interesting question, because in fact, I think that since at least the Renaissance, Italy has had a reputation and factually was a high point of culture, food, of cuisine, as you said, fashion and things like that. When you look at, for example, Italian and French, but Italian perfume, Italian works of art, they have been valued and appreciated by the aristocracy and the elites of the world throughout. For example, in the 19th century, Italy was a massive place of villegiature, of holidays for the British. For example, the rich nobility and the rich British people would go to Italy, to Tuscany, to Naples. In fact, I believe it's the British who funded most of the digs in Pompeii. And Italy was appreciated, if perhaps an industrial backwards, at least the south and the center, was appreciated for that. And you can read a lot of literature about how in the 19th century and even in the first half of the 20th century, even Americans would go to rich Americans, of course, the East Coast elites would go to Italy on holidays, and
the movie with Matt Damon, Gwyneth Paltrow, and Jude Law, The Talented Mr. Ripley, portrays this life very well. They're East Coast socialites. They have a lot of money. They don't work, but they're in Italy for some reason, and they're just enjoying life, la dolce vita. And it's a very perfect portrayal of sort of how the world viewed Italy. It was this sort of pleasant place.
However, people don't realize that Italy in the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century was one of the leading providers of scientists and science in the world. From the Volta and electricity and the batteries in the late 17th century to Fermi, who ended up working in the Manhattan, being one of the lead managers of the Manhattan Project, lead scientist, physician, sorry, I'm not physician, you say in English, you say physicist, of the Manhattan Project in America in the 1940s, Italy had amazing developments of science and technology and industry as well. Even today, Italy is one of the leading industrial powers of the world, and we're talking real industry, trains, electronics. Of course, manufacturing is all outside of Italy. It's in Eastern Europe and in Asia. But Italy was always a country of innovation. And however, the capacity to wage a modern war in 1940, the capacity to produce high quantities of good quality material, for example, Italy had very good aircraft, but they produced a few hundreds, where America could produce tens of thousands of P-51 Mustangs, for example. Italy could produce fairly reasonable vehicles, for example, but only a few hundreds during the war, whereas America could produce, again, tens of thousands of M4 Sherman tanks. So the capacity, Italy had wonderful ships, but they could not match the quantity and perhaps even the crew training quality of the British fleets. So it was just impossible for Italy to wage war, and that was the biggest mistake that Mussolini, in his appreciation of the length of the war and the capacity of the armed forces of Italy, ended up to the disaster. And that disaster was of course watched by Germany, who, because of its intervention in Tunisia, in Sicily, in 1942, could see that the picture on the wall would be that Italy would collapse at some point, and so started to plan for a contingency plan on how to react in case Italy would collapse. And when the German Abwehr, the intelligence, figured out that Italy was negotiating with the British and the Americans, the number of troops that were positioned around Italian troops across Greece, Italy, and so on increased. And when, in fact, the American, I think it was announced on the American radio on September 8th, one day before it was supposed to be announced, because of miscommunication between the Italian negotiators and the English and Americans, well, Germany snapped. The plan snapped, and that operation of German armed forces across that area was Operation Achse, which is ashes in English. Basically, captured more than 1 million Italian troops in 24 hours. And when one thinks of that, of the logistical capacity and the coordination needed to do that, one is just in awe to the genius of German military planning. Because capturing 1 million troops across Italy and coordinating that to happen the same day, Greece, Yugoslavia, the different islands across the Aegean Sea, was just an amazing feat of logistic and coordination. And my grandfather was part of one of the divisions in Greece that was fortunately not attacked by Germans, because there had been a few cases. I think the well-known movie Captain Corelli's Mandolin shows what happened to one of the divisions, that actually Italian division who resisted the German arrest, and they were severely decimated. And my grandfather was captured at that point. And I describe in the book how this indecision and the incapacity of the Italian command to give any order that made sense to the soldiers. So the soldiers didn't know what to do. And when the Germans came and said, look, we would like to drop your weapons and come with us, they say, well, they're probably sending us home.
Wow. I didn't know the scale and speed at which the Germans captured the Italians was that great. I'm curious if you know, and this gets a little bit outside the book, but was this done in secret? And then all of a sudden, these troops that were thought to be friendly became enemies? Or was there just some sort of capturing of the train infrastructure? I mean, I can't even imagine what the plan was, but that's incredible.
Yeah, the plan was I think, if I remember correctly, it was General Kesselring who executed part of the plan, and he was one of the most brilliant military minds ever, probably. He's not well known, not as much as Rommel or others, but he was probably of a superior mind for organization and a pure product of the German military schools. Very, very efficient and pragmatic. What was interesting is that the Italian high command, first of all, it was split between people who were loyalists to the fascist regime, people who were loyalists to the king, and people who were, you know, basically loyalists to the alliance with Germany, and other people who were loyalists, or not loyalists, but they were eager to get with the British and the English and join who looked like would win the war at the time. So there was this split in multiple factions, which created a lot of indecision. The communication systems of the Italian armed forces were very slow. You have to remember that at the time, the Germans had a lot of military attachés to every Italian unit in the land, in the areas where they were coordinating defense against the English and the Americans, including in Greece, but also in Italy. So basically, these military the military troops or officers of German officers attached to Italian units were doing a lot of reports. They were giving information about location, and that was considered absolutely normal because they had to coordinate military movements in case of American landings. And being the coast of Italy and Greece being so wide, so large, landings could happen almost anywhere. So there was a good reason, there was a good pretext to control and know exactly where every single Italian unit was. And so when the order was given to the Germans to seize the Italian units, they knew exactly where to hit and where to capture. And in fact, the interesting, which is a subtle but very important detail, is that Germany was not at war with Italy, of course, because Italy was still an ally. So when Italy signed an armistice with America and England, that didn't mean that Italy would be at war with Germany. It just means that Italy makes a separate, it's not even a peace, it's just a ceasing of hostilities. And so Germany didn't go at war with Italy, it just seized the units, it just seized the military personnel. And basically said, now we would like you to drop your weapons and we are going to control you and bring you into, you know, second line areas so that you cannot fight us, obviously. And so that created the situation, which is a little bit of a legal limbo, where Italy is a non-belligerent, and therefore units who are captured are not prisoners. And that was what made the Italian situation and the soldiers who ended up in the camps in Germany difficult. Because since you're not prisoner of war, you're just a military internee, it has a very different legal signification. And that means that you're not protected by the Geneva Convention on prisoners of war, which Germany absolutely and very dutifully followed when it captured American, British, or French, or Dutch, or Belgian soldiers, which were captured in a legal war. Italy was not at war with Germany. And so these soldiers suddenly, from one day to another, had their own allies, Germans, who captured them, but it's not necessarily with force. You could see a show of force. They could see that the Germans were armed. They could see the machine guns nests in the heights, potentially killing them if they didn't accept. And there were the news of some units of Italy who resisted Germans, who were slaughtered. And at the same time, the Italian command did not give any order to the Italian troops. They just said, we have an armistice with the English and the Americans, and you should resist any aggression. But when Germans came and said, now drop your weapons, this is not technically an aggression, it's an internment. And Italians said, well, if we drop our weapons, they're going to send us home. That's what most people thought. And so that's how, with a little bit of force, a little bit of firm orders, that million, actually it's 1,200,000 Italians got captured. And most of them were sent to Germany, where, in fact, there was a first, they were asked if they wanted to fight on the side of Germany with, because at the same time Mussolini was liberated from captivity by Skorzeny's commandos and parachuters. He created, with the help of the Germans, a new republic in the north part of Italy, as the Americans and English landed in the south, south of Naples. And so very few Italians actually chose to fight with Mussolini at the point because they were really fed up with the war. And they chose to stay in captivity, most of them in Germany. And only later did the south part of Italy had a provisional government which enabled south of Italy to fight on the side of the English and the Americans, of the Allies, at which point Italy entered a phase of civil war, which was extremely brutal. And again, this was not part of my book, but certainly it's a very interesting topic for people to read on, because Italy was not very aggressive in the official war. Italians became very aggressive in the civil war, and they were fighting between monarchists, fascists, and communist, guerrilla bands, and the brutality on civilians on all sides, especially from the communists, was extremely brutal and extremely cruel.
Well, your book does describe with a lot of detail the time your grandfather spent in Germany. This was Eastern Germany. What was the closest major city? I remember you talk about Dresden, but is that the closest? Yeah.
The closest biggest city was Dresden, but the place that the camp was called Hermannstadt, but it's the name of the town eludes me. Actually, I have a chapter where I make fun of Italians trying to learn German names and German towns, which are in a semantic and grammatically very different naming structure than the Italian ones, of course. And that's near where there was the what at the time was called Auto Union, today's Audi, factories in Eastern Germany. So it's in the southern part of East Germany. And yes, there was the trains. They got there, and I described in detail. And that detail was not so much what my grandfather told me. He basically told me, yeah, they were hungry, and he told me anecdotes about food. But I went to German archives to figure out how exactly was organized the life of these camps. So basically, of course, the discipline was very strict. I was surprised to discover how much German organization put an effort on making sure everyone was clean. Every dress, every clothes, every person had to be thoroughly clean, washed at least once a week, with every garment going into special equipment that would make them against any lice or bad risk of epidemics. And my grandfather was joking, said, well, we could die at any time, but at least we were dying clean, which is not what you hear from usually accounts from prisoners of war, where people say, oh, it's not true. In Germany, the cleanliness was very important for Germans. They were obsessed about epidemics, rightfully so. In fact, that was happening. You know, most people in camps died from epidemics in the end of the war.
Yeah, typhus.
Because, all that system couldn't work anymore. So I was surprised to see how efficient the system was to keep the people clean, how efficient it was organized so that there were people were organized in groups of a certain number so that it would be easy to count, easy to remember. Every house and every door, while all these camps had big, long houses where everyone was in, and the calculation of every food, calorie, quantity of calories and so on were calculated in a very scientific way. I was really surprised how Germany was organized, was organizing everything as a machine, as a very efficient machine, including prisoners.
Yeah, well, much of this was from Albert Speer, who took charge of the war production effort, and his mind was very mathematical, and I think this pattern is very well evidenced in the way the camps, they were labor camps. I mean, people think they were death camps, but that never made any sense to me. Even if you believe in the Holocaust story, why would the Germans destroy their own labor force? It didn't make much sense, that theory. And you talk about cleanliness. We haven't really done a Auschwitz show. I don't think we ever will, but there's lots of material out there. Look into what Zyklon B was used for. It had a lot to do with getting rid of lice. So I think it's...
Yeah, lice was a big problem. And it was a responsibility of the prisoners to... And again, let me emphasize, this was not a death camp. But this was a prisoner of war camp. The only difference was legally, the Italians were not considered prisoners of war. In fact, in the camp, there were areas where there would be American and English. They were grouped by language, prisoner of war. There were other areas where there would be French and Belgian, and other areas where there would be Polish and Russians. Again, Russians, for example, were not exterminated in German prisoner camps. They were not treated as well as the English and Americans. If only because, just like the Italians, they were not receiving Red Cross parcels. And I explain, you've probably seen as well in the book, the luxurious quantity of food that Americans, British, sometimes French, would receive in terms of the American Red, from the American and British Red Cross, which were sending these guys food from all the way from Australia, including, you know, dried resins and canned tuna and canned food. No one starved in the American and French, no one starved in the German prison camps. That is just not true. And however, the Italians and the Russians didn't have the Red Cross, the Russians because the Russian was not part of it, but the Italian was because they were not at war with Germany. So the Red Cross couldn't send the Italian Red Cross would, why would the Italian Red Cross send food to Italians, prisoners who were not prisoners? And then the Italian Red Cross was completely disorganized. So they were, only the Germans could manage to get some in packs and letters sent, but only much later in the war. So in fact, it was, while of course there was harsh treatment for anyone who tried to escape or steal anything, it was not sadist. It was not brutal in the way that maybe some movies might have shown, or maybe people who imagine concentration camps for political prisoners or for foreigners. This was not the same at all. It was not fun. It was not good. And you had to work. Indeed, you're right. All the prisoners were, for extra food, they were convinced that they had to work in factories. My grandfather worked for the truck manufacturing of the engines of the Audi auto union trucks. And because the food was better. So obviously, yeah, of course you would work. And in fact, when you enter those camps, when there is this famous writing, Arbeit macht frei, working makes you free, the prisoners wondered if that was a bit of a joke or if it was actually true. And actually they did find out that if they worked, they were fed, and they were fed properly if they did some good work. However, as the war went on, all of this system collapsed. And of course, then the food didn't arrive. Even the factories where they were working were flattened. I describe a lot of that in detail. And then they suffered, of course, from hunger and from the cold. And of course, Italians being a bit creative and they had to organize black market with the French and the Americans to get food in. And even the Germans, by the end of the war, even the guards, and I think I show that there are some humane and obviously, of course, I mean, Germans are human beings, obviously, and are humane. And there are even some friendship and bonds of friendship that are created between the guards and the prisoners. And they suffer themselves as well, because their families maybe die in the war or in the bombings. Germany was prepared with food storage. They had stocked a lot of food in case of a long war, but at the end, that storage was finishing. There was no more sugar, no more coffee, no more flour to make bread, and so it became difficult for everyone. So I think the German authorities tried to feed the prisoners of war as much as they could, but when in end of 1994 and early 1945 the war got to the end, the prisoners could not be fed, just as the German people could not be fed.
By the end of World War II, like, the German civilian population was, you know, I'm looking at some data that's indicated that even German civilians, the average calorie intake by 1945 is like 1,400 calories per day equivalent, which is, you know, at that point, you're riding pretty close to the tail end of a famine. And
well, it had regressed back to like the early Great Depression period in Weimar, when you can find photos of a German family of like seven or eight, you know, mom, dad, and the kids. And there's on the little table, there's one loaf of bread and one long sausage. And the implication is that the whole family is going to share like a 3 foot long sausage and a small loaf of bread between them for dinner. And had just kind of
comes
fallen
up over
fallen
and
back.
Over in the like Goebbels, I think it's Goebbels' diary. Like, there's like copious documentation of how tight their food supplies were and trying to figure out, like, okay, I have soldiers, they're carrying a lot of heavy stuff and running as fast as they can. They get fed first, but I also need to feed the farm laborers because that's where food comes from. And now I'm basically out of food. So what do you actually do? It's not a great situation.
And indeed, most of the dead in those camps happened in early 1945, which was also a very cold winter. And even if food was available, the disruption of the bombings across Germany, of the destruction of the bridges, of the railways, just became so difficult to transport from one place to another. And as you said, the priority was to the soldiers, to the war machine. And this is all of this is not to even to I think people who read my books, I don't have any hate or side in this story. I'm just describing the suffering of everyone, the German people, which, you know, in the later part of the book, you know, my grandfather's camp was liberated by the Soviet army, advancing Soviet army. Before that, of course, the prisoners were moved because they were kept as an exchange possibility against even when the there was orders to shoot the prisoners at the end of the war, but this order was not carried through by the SS. The camps were managed by the SS by the end of the war, and the SS said, well, if we do something bad to prisoners, we would be, of course, shot ourselves. And some of them were, even if they didn't do anything, by either Americans or Russians. So it was a very tense time in the last few months of the war. And my grandfather was telling me that he saw bombings and he saw a big city burn. And I deducted that was Dresden, which was only about 80 miles away. And so I described the bombing of Dresden by British and American bombers, which was an incredible slaughter of civilians. And I tried to say, well, look, this is the point of the problem with war, is you always know when it starts, you always think it's a good idea and you will have victory. But in the end, it's a disaster. People suffer. And this is why the we have to always remember, and this is, you know, we describe all this destruction and suffering. And then, of course, people have the guts to talk about white privilege. I mean, all the people who died in this story, all the people who died in Dresden, all the people who died in these prison camps, all the people who died in the war, whether it's in the Greek front, the Russian front, whatever, all these people were white. And why were they at war after all? And was there other people pushing them to war? So this is not the core of the story, for sure, because I tell the story from the point of view of a simple man and from the perspective of an Italian soldier, which is not a well-known story. Funny, if I open a small parenthesis, at the genesis of the book, I was contacted by one of my literary agents in the Anglo world, and he said, "Why, you know, we like your survival books, and why don't you write a book for a movie for Netflix, because they look for stories." So I told him, "Well, look, when they look." I'm not sure they're going to take anything I write, but hey, what the hell? I'm going to do one. I'm trying. So I wrote a story, and then he liked it and said, you should really get it published. It's a very interesting and original story, at least in the English world. No one, you know, there's very few stories about Italians in World War II. And he said, I don't know about Netflix. And I said, well, in the end, you know, I don't want to have... I don't know, Cuba Gooding Jr. to play my grandfather anyway, or having Morgan Freeman playing one of the camp guards. No, probably the Germans would always be whites in Netflix, but to have, Italians played by black actors on a Netflix show, so I'm not sure it's going to happen ever. But so I close that parenthesis. But certainly, towards the end of the book, the chaos, you know, in Germany was so high. You could see prisoners on the roads, escorted by old guards who were veterans of World War One. You could see young 14-year-old boys in the SS walking to Berlin for probably what would be their death, absolutely certain death, to fight for the Führer, and you would have German fleeing on the roads with horses and carts and cars, whatever, or by on foot in the snow, trying to flee the advancing Red Army because they knew how brutally they would be treated by the advancing Soviets, who were motivated by the political commissars to rape and kill German men and certainly rape the women. And this is a very sad. I know a lot of people who wrote the book, they were actually crying when they were into those chapters, because when Dresden, which was leveled, when you see that the survivors were brutally handled and the woman raped by Soviet, I don't know, troops it's just sad. On a human suffering level, you just can only realize how much suffering went on, and all of this for geopolitical reasons which had nothing to do with the interest of the common people. And it's important, I think, to tell these stories, because today we are at the we are on the brink of the resurgence of this craziness, whether it's statism from Bolsheviks who are running again the show in many countries, or for people who are just drunk with power and they want to impose whatever crazy ideas they have. We are entering again times that could lead us to disasters such as the one that we have seen in the end of World War II. And we have to be, and perhaps it's too late, but we have to understand that these stories, that like the one I'm trying to tell using my grandfather as a small guy, which you did probably notice towards the end of the book, suddenly he grows a pair. At some point he stops being a subject of history and he wants to act, and he just says, stop, I'm not taking this BS anymore. I want to go home, and now that I'm not in a camp anymore, now that I'm surrounded, now that we have been liberated by the Soviets, can I go home? I want to go home. And the Soviet says, well, you do what you want. You're not into, you know, if you're here, we'll feed you. But if you go, we don't care, because we have a war to finish. And this is also a not very well-known fact of World War II, but Italy had been at war with the Soviet Union. And so Italian prisoners, when liberated by the Red Army, they were scared that they would be treated just as bad as the Germans were. The Germans were decimated as well by when they were captured by the Soviets. But Stalin, who was, you can say what you want about Stalin, but he was politically astute. He knew that after the war, Italy was not in his control, because Italy was conquered by Americans and English and French. But he knew that there would be elections after the war, so he wanted, as fast as possible, Italian prisoners to go back to Italy, and he gave orders expressively to treat them well and to make a little bit of political indoctrination so that when they would go back, they would try to vote communist. And that is why, and of course, my grandfather couldn't know that. So I explained this in the notes of the book. When the Soviets liberated Italian troops, they treated them well, they fed them, they gave them clothes, but at the same time, they were busy fighting the war and trying to go as far west as they could to the other, to join with the Americans and the English. And so so they basically brought the officers, which had been separated from the troops, the Italian officers, back with the Italian troops and basically said to the officers, well, you manage your troops. And so the officers started again to boss around the Italian soldiers, which after 2 years being alone and in camps, they were fed up with that. They were fed up with the war and receiving orders. So in fact, a lot just said, well, go to hell and went home. And my grandfather was part of those who went home by foot in May and June 1945. And he told me that he went across what was to become the Czech Republic, and he witnessed ethnic cleansing by the Czechs against Russian Sudeten, the people, the Germans, the ethnic Germans who were living in those areas. And I made a story where he meets a German survivor, which was, I think, quite an interesting story for readers to see the point of view of those Germans. And then he ended up in Bayern, in the American zone, and he could. That is obviously my. I must admit, this was my thing. But I added the awe that he has when he crosses American held areas to see the vast quantity of military material that America has mobilized for this war, and he was in awe when he saw the quantity of Soviet troops and machines. And when he gets into near Munich and he sees the immense quantity of American troops and materiel and tanks and artillery that were under Patton, Third Army, he just has this realization that what the hell were they trying to do in Italy against such powerful powers in the world? And so he has this realization that he, like many millions of others, have been played. In fact, they have been lured into a war that they had no chance of ever winning, at least on the Italian side. And so eventually he gets home, and I think you will see that in what happened when he gets home, because we think, especially in today's culture in America, we talk about these people as the greatest generation, and these veterans have been well treated. They came home, they came back to America. They had college paid for them. They had they were treated as heroes. And people like my grandfather, when they came home, people were just out of the Civil War. They had the cities bombed. They had no time to listen to what he went through in German camps. So, you know, they basically said, well, look, I'm sure that what you have to say is very interesting, but we're all really busy working and building the country again. So why don't you shut up and come and help us to work. I tell the story that, of course, someone jokes saying, who knows, maybe some people will be bold enough to actually make money out of telling stories of being in camps. And another guy says, well, that can't be. No one will be as vulgar and crude to actually try that.
No, it's important to understand how this happened. Yeah, I was a little bit surprised by the reception that your grandfather said he got when he got back. People were complaining that their experience had been worse than being a prisoner, or at least an internee in a very, very difficult part of the world that was being bombed and running out of food. But I think you made the good point that people have a hard time understanding other people's suffering unless they're together. And yeah, it's the lack of empathy, I think, that causes a lot of conflict to begin with. And it's really the sympathy that brings us together. I don't know what lessons we can draw from this, because unfortunately we don't have the ability to influence our government. I think that's become very clear recently, but short of walking into the the forest and disappearing, which is what a lot of your work actually focuses on, and how to actually survive these situations. How do we little people manage and navigate the future with the global tensions that seem to be being amplified by the leadership to either distract us or to just to gather more control for them?
It is very difficult, because clearly the lesson from those times was maybe one should voice his opinion, maybe one should look for the truth, maybe one should challenge the leaders and the organization that they lead, the state, to do what's really good for the people and not what is good for anyone's ambition or agenda, but to focus on the people. And especially today, I think we have to be very careful and attentive not to be demotivated. We've been suffering for 50 years, if not more, of propaganda against us as people, as a race, as a people, as a nation, and I mean this in the anthropological point of view. Everything has been made to antagonize us, to demotivate us, to make us feel powerless, to make us feel weak and isolated. And perhaps these kind of stories show us that, first of all, there is hope in going through even the direst and the worst situations, and in our, we know people in Israel who tell stories about how you survive extermination. Okay, well, let's assume the stories are correct and true. Well, there is a lesson to be taken, is that even when there is attempt of extermination, true or exaggerated, there is still hope, there is still survival, there is still something. And the survival can happen in many ways. Indeed, you can be one day after the other. You can take one little step after the other. After all, we're not yet in the world of 1984, of George Orwell's book. We're getting there, but we're not yet completely there. We're certainly not yet, we're also getting there, in the world of the Soviet Union in the 1920s and 30s. We're not yet in Stalin's world. We're getting there, but we're not yet there. So we can move, we can get on the fringe, we can disappear, we can get, we can regroup elsewhere, we can regroup within countries. After all, some countries, Eastern Europe, had 50 years of communism, and they survived actually pretty well. So maybe we can think of ways to organize ourselves, to communicate, to beat censorship. We can go degrees of technology lower that don't allow so much surveillance and censorship. There are many, many ways, and we should explore many of those at the same time, simultaneously, because we have lost a lot of ground where we shouldn't have. And it doesn't mean that we need to lose much more, but of course, when you face the power of the state and you feel that you're alone, it's difficult. But when you're many together, maybe you can organize. And maybe the point is not to conquer power in the capital or in the capital city of the country. Maybe it's good enough to have power within your area. And by power, I mean independence and freedom. I'm not talking about ego and deciding and policies. Maybe just have living in a county where you are, your ideas, your philosophy is majoritary, and therefore no one comes and tells you how to live. And sometimes you have to be smart. Sometimes you have to do things in secret. People had fun. People reproduced, met women and men and had children in the depths of Russia during the communist times, during the occupation of Czech Republic and Poland and Hungary. They survived. So there are many ways. So in fact, the point is not to be demotivated, not to feel dark. I know it's sometimes difficult. Right now it's a difficult time, I know, for all of us, for all the world. unless you're Chinese, but that's another story. It's certainly we are entering dark times for children, for anyone who likes freedom. And so maybe these stories can help us to take some hope, to take some ideas. And maybe a lesson is that you have to tell the truth instead of just going along with the flow. There is some risk doing that, however. So it's up to us to think, what kind of risk are we willing to take? But I certainly am not the one who will tell people what to do. I'm just exploring options and giving ideas.
You know, you said something earlier that stuck with me. In the context of Garibaldi's invasion of the South, you mentioned that it's not taught in Italian schools or conventionally in Italian schools. Is the Italian story of the 20th century not adequately taught as well? Is it, in your estimation, you know, anything akin to the story that you've told? Is anything like that in the mainstream Italian education system? Do people take to heart Italy's sacrifices during the war? Do they try and see both sides, or is it never really presented to anyone as something a bit more human than just a series of events?
Yes, in at school and in the narrative post World War II, there has been many official narratives that have been a little bit in conflict, because the left, the communists, the progressives, they have a narrative that is different than the one from the state, because they play to a different clientele, customers, voting customers, different plantations, let's put it this way. And so there has been in Italy different voices and even different official stories which were conflicting, which is quite unique and probably unsurprising if you know Italian characters and the difference between the North and the South and the bourgeoisie and the working classes. So, and all of this is taken with a lot of salt, not just a grain of salt, but a lot of it, in the sense that, you know, Italians, they have the king, and then they have fascists, and then they have democracy. But what really matters is to have good food and go on the motorcycle and check out the nice girls. So there is something of the genius of Italians is to not care too much. But on the other hand, it has the flaw of not being able to organize and really to find themselves only during crises. And right now, 2021, at the beginning of 2021, Italy is 1 year into the worst crisis since 1945, much worse than any economic crisis that it has ever gone through since 1945. Because the policies against this thing that we cannot even name in most networks have been so disastrous on the economy that the people are at the breaking point. They're at the point of revolt. They're at the point of not caring anymore and not following any rule that the government says anymore. Because they also figure out that the statistics, you know, statistics don't lie. When you have 0.05 death rate, even if you show death people and all dead people on TV every day, after a while, you start to add up 1 + 1, and usually it makes 2, not 3. And so Italy is right now at the breaking point. And where will that lead? Impossible to say. Most of the young are unemployed. The economy, the small businesses, which are the heart of the Italian economy, are almost dead. And they were forced to die. There's no customers. You are forced to be closed. For 1 year, shops have been closed very often. And in a very, I don't know if it's the same in the United States, but in a very, one day it's, you have to close at 6 o'clock, and then next week it's 9 o'clock in the evening, and then it's restaurants, but not gyms, and then it's gyms, but not restaurants. All of this looks like torture, like psychological torture, and maybe it is, but it also looks a lot like incompetent buffoons that are politicians, not knowing what they do and trying to pleasure the different lobbies from the economy, from the pharmaceuticals, from the international organizations that push agendas. So all of this looks like a mess, and people, when they have enough and the food in the fridge is decreasing and there's no more money on the 20th of the month to pay the month, well, this is where revolutions happen. And Italy is pushed at this because it was a resident economic crisis before this COVID crisis. And because of internet, people, you know, they look for information, and the majority of people don't believe the narration anymore. They don't believe the official stories anymore. So who knows where it goes? It's really difficult.
There was a speech or a presentation given in the Italian parliament talking about, I think, naming Bill Gates like an enemy of Italy. I don't know if you saw that. That was in the beginning of 2020. I don't remember the details, but I was only shocked because, of course, we talk about this constantly in the United States about the conspiracy to depopulate the human race with some kind of injection. But you probably don't have Alex Jones in Italy, but it was surprising that the government was actually raising things like that, because in the U.S. Congress, they never talk about reality. It's always fantasy. And that was shocking to me. I don't know if you saw that, but if you have any comments.
Yes, I do. In Italy, because there are many parties, it's actually in Switzerland where I live, and there's also the same thing. The biggest party, the opposition party in Switzerland, which is the biggest, has voiced not yesterday, basically is asking for a confidence vote against the minister who's managing the crisis, which is a socialist, not unsurprisingly, and basically saying that the crisis has been mismanaged and that there is abuse of power and they don't know what they're doing. So we start to have encounters where there is opposition and many political parties. We start to have political parties who are, you know, taking advantage of the people's discontent. And for once, you know, it's really welcomed. Of course, in one party systems like in the US, more and more, like in France, like in Britain, you don't have that. And so there is this, they double on the bet that they have to continue and do more and more authoritarian laws. And now, unfortunately, there is censorship as well in Italy today, just as there is in Switzerland, just as there is in France, because we use the same social network, the same news, and the state-owned news are corrupt, of course, just as the state is. And by corrupt, I don't mean just money. In every single country, including in Italy, including in Switzerland, we have people getting caught for pedophilia in the media, in the left, and it's common. And of course, people are upset about that, obviously. In the private-owned media, well, they are part of big groups, and they're the same as in the US, and they all say exactly the same thing the same day with the same images, the same narration. And, I mean, a lot of people notice that there is a plan. We don't know exactly what is the plan, but there is a plan. This is clear. And I have this feeling, but maybe I'm just hopeful. I'm wishful thinking maybe, but I have a feeling that they have overplayed their hand here. And maybe they are winning in the US right now because of the situation that we have seen over the last 6 months. And maybe soon to be former President Trump was not exactly the Napoleon Bonaparte most of us hoped in the world. He's too old for that, by the way. But still, I think there is a revolt feeling. And again, we should not be demoralized. But certainly I see it could be that they overplayed their hand. I mean, everywhere you see majority, and I really mean majority of people who are against vaccine. And it's not for me to say, I'm not a doctor, whether it's good or bad, but usually when something is new and untested, you should try to be cautious with it. And even if it's a car or a computer, don't buy the first model, wait. And again, for what? For something that kills 0.05% of the population? You know, people notice. People know that no one knows people who die. So, I don't know, after a while, you say, yeah, grandpa died, but he was 94 years old. Yeah, well, you know, it happens. Mm-hmm. He would have died anyway. So, and the media play up, of course. Oh, there's this 21-year-old girl who died the other day. Yeah, but that's one out of millions. So people are stupid, but not that stupid. They I think more and more there is a anti-narrative that starts to grow. Of course, it's censored big time, but people talk, and every single person I talk in the last month is upset, whether it's in Italy, in France, or Switzerland, where I live. Everyone, and I tell you, upset people in Switzerland. That has never happened.
Yeah. I have to ask you, because last time you visited our show, I asked you about the World Economic Forum in Davos in Switzerland, and there has been a bit of a talk on the internet about this Klaus Schwab character who has been talking about the Great Reset with extreme detail, which I almost have a hard time believing. But there was a video.
Well, his new shtick is the fourth industrial revolution bit, where he speaks about like merging your physical and digital identity, and it's like Looney Tunes tier bad guy narrative. You know, he's just, I think on some level they must get a kick out of being this obvious and getting away with it.
Well, also what his organization was talking about in this video that I saw was how people are not going to live in the country anymore. They're going to live in these smart cities. They're going to eat plant-based food. Meat is going away. And we're not going to own anything. And lastly, we're going to be happy. Because he tells us to. What does people in Switzerland think about this man and about what the people who are not really Swiss, who are basically the billionaires and oligarchs of the world who meet in Davos, what do they think about that man, his organization, and the people who go to Davos?
Yeah, now I met the guy once, and
oh, great.
And my father, when he was in business, and we're talking 20 years ago, so everyone was much younger, he was kind of friend with him. And I've been to Davos World Economic Forum once when I was in the business, in the industries, to be there when I was working for Salesforce.com. I was there to host people like Michael Dell and other of these rich, well, powerful guys who were going there. So my impression is this. First of all, these guys, they're a think tank. It's like the Bilderberg Conference. It's not exactly... You know, we have to put this in a real thing. It's people who kind of think alike, who meet, and clearly there's an agenda. Clearly they have directions of thought, and they sometimes test ideas. And what you describe is, you know, what they say. It's not a secret. This is why it's not a conspiracy. It's absolutely open, and it's a... But what I would say is, first of all, even the people who attend, they don't all agree. They're in the same world, of course. They dine together, they mingle together, they have sex together sometimes, but they're in the same world. So they disagree sometimes, just as you would disagree in a high school. So it's the same dynamic. And people say, no, your ideas are crazy. And some people say, well, after all, communism for the poor people is a better idea because poor people are stupid. So let us rich people keep being in the capitalist world, and the state manages the masses as cattle and for a while. And when there will be not enough resources for everyone, we will have machines and we don't need the poor people anymore. So that's one trend. Another trend is for people to say, no, let's have market forces manage the thing, but let me have a good impression of myself by having social ideas and generosity, especially if it's done with other people's money. So you have this kind of rich people in a bubble talking about stuff, but they don't really realize the reality of the world. And I think a lot of people, a lot of the common people, they don't really like these guys, but not yet with hostility. because it's not is there not yet a machine, and probably they advance like many of those things, you know, two pass, they make two passes forward and then they move back one. They tell, oh, vaccination must be mandatory, and then they say, oh, no, we can't do that. So vaccination will be, you know, suggested, and private companies would probably make it mandatory, but the state will never make it mandatory. And then maybe 5 years from now, they will say, oh, no, it has to be mandatory, because anyway, a majority of people are already doing it if they're still alive. And so this is not a monolith. It's very movable. And as for the people, I'm not sure that these plans will be advancing as fast as these people would like, because there are, you know, China and Russia, they don't play this game. And vast majority, this is a game only played by some rich people, but who are in control of the West. But the rest of the world is chaotic. It's, you know, you think African countries, they follow the rules. They don't follow the rules. They haven't, they play lip service, but they don't follow. Latin America doesn't follow. Asian countries they're doing very well. Thank you very much. They have their own agendas. They don't care about all these things. So this seems to me, my opinion, and it's just me, I don't know if I'm right or not. This seems to me like people discussing, you know, the gender of angels when the enemy is at the gates. In that's a reference to Constantinople's siege in 1452. And this seems to me like the craziness of people who are in a bubble while the house is burning around them. We have energy problems. We have resource issues. We have people losing jobs massively in the West, and they talk about putting chips in people's skins. I mean, I am worrying for their lives, in fact, and their long-term survival. But what do I know?